TED Audio Collective.
Reboot your credit card with Apple Card, the only credit card designed for iPhone. It gives you up to 3% daily cash back on every purchase. Plus, Apple Card has no fees, not even hidden ones. Apply for Apple Card now in the wallet app on iPhone. Apple Card issued by Goldman Sachs Bank USA, Salt Lake City branch, subject to credit approval. Variable APRs for Apple Card range from 19.24% to 29.49% based on creditworthiness. Rates as of February 1st, 2024. Terms and more at applecard.com.
This episode is brought to you by Progressive. Are you driving your car or doing laundry right now? Podcasts go best when they're bundled with another activity. Like Progressive home and auto policies, they're best when they're bundled too. Having these two policies together makes insurance easier and could help you save. Customers who save by switching their home and car insurance to Progressive save nearly $800 on average. Quote a home and car bundle today at progressive.com. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. National average 12-month savings of $793 by new customers surveyed who saved with Progressive between June 2021 and May 2022. Potential savings will vary.
So many well-intentioned people go slowly out of fear of breaking things. And when I say so many, I'm going to round it off to everyone.
From the TED Audio Collective, this is Design Matters with Debbie Millman. For 19 years, Debbie Millman has been talking with designers and other creative people about what they do, how they got to be who they are, and what they're thinking about and working on. On this episode, Frances Frei and Anne Morriss talk about organizational transformation.
There's a lot you can do in a week.
There's so much you can do in a week.
Move fast and break things. This was an informal motto at Facebook for many years, and it exemplified an ethos in Silicon Valley about how to aggressively conduct business in a rapidly changing world. Move Fast and Fix Things is the title of the latest book by Frances Frei and Anne Morriss. The subtitle of their book is The Trusted Leader's Guide to Solving Hard Problems. Frances Frei is a professor of technology and operations management at Harvard Business School and a business strategist for companies like Uber and WeWork. Anne Morriss is a CEO and author. They're married, and together they host the podcast Fixable, which, like Design Matters, is part of the TED Audio Collective. Frances Frei and Anne Morriss, welcome at long last to Design Matters.
Yay.
Oh, thank you. We're so delighted to be here.
I am just thrilled. And listeners, we are at the TED conference in a podcast studio. And so that's why it might sound a little bit different than it might usually when I'm doing a podcast in my studio. So, Anne and Frances, ordinarily, for my first question, I like to ask my guest, or in this case, guests, a question that might surprise them. I do this to break the ice, so to speak, and hope the question and the answer will put my guests at ease. But in doing my research for the show, I discovered that you both have a go-to question for your guests on your podcast.
You do?
Yeah. Wow. Or I've heard it a number of times. Huh. And it was too juicy an opportunity to pose the question to ask you both. So here it is. What was your favorite breakfast as a child?
Yeah, we do. We do ask that frequently.
Wow.
Out in the world, it's so revealing because you can't answer the question without giving away a lot about your childhood.
Yes.
So my favorite breakfast was Golden Grahams with half and half.
Half and half?
Because that's what my mother used to eat at her most playful.
Wow.
I would sneak it as a snack, I think, to connect to that part of her. She was a single mom, and that wasn't always what she was leading with. But the Golden Grahams and half and half, which is an extraordinary choice, would give away that side of her.
Frances, what about you?
A bacon sandwich.
Yeah, now I understand that you had to have it made very specifically. So it was two pieces of lightly toasted bread with a little bit of butter and bacon.
Yes, and the bacon couldn't be too crisp.
That's the part that really concerned me.
Yeah.
Why not crisp bacon? Is there anything better in the world than crisp bacon?
It's such a good follow-up. It's such a good follow-up.
Crisp bacon almost needn't be consumed.
Anne.
What kind of a statement
is that?
That's like
a deal breaker. I can't believe you married this woman.
Well, no one, she's never said this before. It's been 20 years.
But it's why
she's now feeling safe enough to confess.
Well, it's also why whenever bacon is delivered, we never fight over any of the pieces.
Ah.
You take the well done end. I take the less well done. Yeah. And it's not like I like anything else less well done. All meat has to be enormously well done for me to consume it. But bacon is meant to be chewy, just like the soft bread is meant to be chewy.
Okay, let's move on.
This is a controversial interview already.
So now I have a bonus question for you both, because I had my original icebreakers before I discovered the breakfast question. So, Frances, you first. Is it true that it's difficult for you to imagine 48 hours going by without consuming some stand-up comedy?
Impossible. There has never been a 48-hour period where I haven't consumed some stand-up comedy.
Who are your go-to comedians?
Well, I go through them very quickly, as you can imagine. I metabolize them, so I'll consume everything, like literally everything they have, and then I'm done with them, and then I go on to the next one. So recent meals, Leanne Morgan, who was late in life comedian, maybe started in her mid-40s. Kathleen Madigan is another one I'm consuming right now.
Well, what is it about comedy that you like so much?
It's super smart, it's unexpected, and the quality per unit time is through the roof. So some people who like poetry, I don't know how to consume it, but if I did know how to consume things, I would like poetry because of the quality per unit word. And there is almost nothing like it for comedy. I mean, it's just, they will practice for 5 years and then show us the best 60 minutes from it. It is a love letter to us.
Yeah, I think it's in many ways, a microcosm of how we all behave in our culture.
Say more.
Well, just that they're so astute about pointing out things that we might take for granted or might not even know that we behave in a certain way or certain prejudices or certain biases. They point out so, if they're really good, point out so succinctly.
And they'll have had the thought and then literally will test it in front of 1,000 audiences before I ever consume it.
Yeah.
Well, that's like unbelievable. My question is, why aren't others watching it?
Well, sometimes people don't want to face what they need to face, I think. But going back to poetry, after this podcast, I am going to send you 5 poems that I think will change your mind about poetry.
I would love to have my mind changed about poetry. I have always wanted to be able to consume it. I just never have been able to.
What are the 5?
Well, my go-to favorite poem of all time is a poem by Charles Olson called Maximus to Himself, which is why Roxanne and I named our dog Maximus. Toretto Blueberry Milman Gay. And that poem starts out with the line, I have had to learn the simplest things last, which made for difficulties. So that's definitely one of my go-to poems.
I know I will already like poetry better if it's read to me.
I'll send you a poem by Rainer Maria Rilke called The Panther. I will send you, I don't know, I'll have to pick one of many written by Ellen Bass, who lives in Santa Cruz and is frequently in The New Yorker, and she is remarkable. I will likely send you something by Marie Howe, H-O-W-E, who's also remarkable. And then I think I might throw in a surprise. Fifth.
I'll read all of them to you, baby.
There we go.
So, Anne, your turn. Mm. Is it true that you spent a lot of time imagining that you were fighting in the American Revolution as you were growing up? Like that one was so juicy. I could not give it up, even with the breakfast.
Deep, an extraordinary amount of time.
One question.
I mean,
why?
I assume you have many follow-ups. I don't know why. I'm a believer in the examined life, but I don't think I've spent any time on this one. It's among the most vivid memories of my childhood. And I would spend a long time in the woods.
By yourself or with other people?
This wasn't a game that a lot of other people wanted to play.
Surprising.
So it really was in my head. It has been reported to me by my brothers that I also went through a period of sleepwalking. And their most vivid memory was me in the middle of the night standing at the top of the steps reciting the give me liberty or give me death speech, Nathan Hale, obviously. And I don't remember that, but it tracks with my other waking choices.
Now, I'm going to volley back and forth by topic. So I'm going to talk about your upbringing now, and then I'll go to yours. And so I don't want you to feel left out. Then I'm just going to focus on Anne for a few minutes.
She's my favorite topic. I'll never feel left out.
Well, and vice versa when I get to you. Okay. And you were born without a heartbeat.
Yeah.
And the medical team at the time was not optimistic you would make it and actually told your parents that you were unlikely to have full cognitive functioning. How did you end up having a heartbeat and surviving that birth?
Yeah. My Apgar scores, which are a measure of your vitality at birth, at I think it's 1 minute, 5 minutes, and 7 minutes, and a scale of 1 to 10. So I might be a little bit off, but I think I'm directionally right on the scale. But I was 0 at birth, 0 at 1 minute, and a 1 at either 5 or 7 minutes, whatever the next number is. So it was not looking good. Somehow, the medicine at the time, the technology at the time, kind of pulled me back from the brink. So I have no memory of that. Although I've been, as Frances knows, I've been increasingly intrigued by the birth trauma, the category of birth trauma. But I think what probably impacted my earliest years more is I think the family kind of didn't know what direction this was going. And so my mother has shared with me that she didn't want to overwhelm me with conventional toys. And so she would give me like a spoon to play with rather than, you know, a
teddy bear,
a doll or something. And there's something so delicious about the idea of me like sitting on the floor with a spoon, just like, what the fuck am I supposed to do with this?
Yeah, I mean, I read that she had a fear of overstimulating you, but I wondered why playing with spoons and making the sort of noises that you can with spoons would be less stimulating than cuddling
no,
with a teddy
bear. No, I think
bear.
It's probably more stimulating.
You have gotten to the riddle, the ultimate riddle of Anne's upbringing.
Well, I think a developmental specialist lived down the block and so came for a visit, and I think my mother asked for some guidance on kind of what kind of informal testing she might do. And there was, at the time, there was this idea of a pincer test. So if I could pick something up with my two fingers, it was a sign that I was on track. And so according to the mythology, she spread some raisins out on the floor with my spoon. I guess I had to put my spoon down. And I not only did I pick up the raisins, Debbie, I ate the raisins, and I think just settled the discussion.
Well, you ended up having exceptional cognitive functioning, and I understand when you graduated from Harvard Business School, your mom wanted to find the doctor that delivered you to show him how you turned out. Yeah. Did she actually find him?
I honestly don't know, but it does reveal how much it got embedded in her own psychology. This question of whether I was going to be okay. And I think that question kind of hung over the household a little bit.
Your dad passed away when you were 2 years old, but before he passed, he taught constitutional law at West Point and was famously involved in banning the practice of mandatory chapel for cadets and was accused by some at the time of killing God. So
killing God
post-Nietzsche,
at West Point, at
post-Nietzsche, but nevertheless, do you think you got your rebellious nature from him?
I do think I inherited some piece of that on the personality front. I mean, the other feature of the household is we all grew up with this kind of mythology of this great man who was formative kind of for three brothers, two I grew up with in the same house. So this story of my father was everywhere, but he physically was absent. And so I think that had a big impact on me, how I thought about what a meaningful life meant. And I think the idea of not accepting the status quo as static and that you had a certain obligation to make the world a more just and righteous place, I think I definitely took that away from the story of his life.
I read that I think Frances considers you as a young girl as a justice warrior.
Yeah, that's a very Frances phrase. And maybe that was part of the American Revolution. The version of that story that so captivated me was a story of justice warriors refusing to accept the status quo.
Your mom raised you and your siblings in Cincinnati, Ohio as a single mom. You're the youngest of your siblings and the only girl. Frances, you grew up on Long Island, and you were the youngest of six. Your mom had four girls and two boys by the time she was 25 years old.
Which is
so astonishing.
It's so old school.
Now, you said that being the youngest of six is a superpower. How so?
Oh, because Anne and I joke that every year around taxes time, we're like, did you do the taxes? Did you do the taxes? Only the youngest gets to do that. The oldest did the taxes.
I was the oldest of four. And so I totally understand. But I think being the oldest is a superpower. I think it's the middle kids that just get, you know, screwed.
Can I just say for the record, we have always filed our taxes. It's just sometimes been a rush.
Yeah. And for the record, I have never participated. So if you ask which one of us really embodies the youngest, it's me.
It's interesting because I know you really are a numbers person and Anne is more of a words person. And so I would have thought that you did the text.
Oh, yeah, but it's not an ideal distribution of labor, Debbie.
But Anne is more responsible.
Ah, okay. Frances, growing up, you were extremely gifted in math and at sports. Otherwise, you didn't really feel comfortable, and you stated this: I felt like I didn't get a lot of secret memos, and everyone would come to the table, and everyone knew something that I didn't. My whole life, I was like, there's another secret memo I didn't get. And secret memos came up a few times in my research, where you've said that in other instances. And so I'm wondering, what gave you that impression and what did you imagine was in the secret memo?
Oh, I can give you just the highlights, but we've just signed our next book, which is going to be called The Secret Memos, because I feel like the greatest gift we can give to people is distribute the secret memos.
Oh my God, I love that.
Yeah, so we're
breaking news.
Breaking news, yeah.
Exclusive. Matters at 10.
I remember, so youngest of six, but so the fourth girl. So as an example, when I got my period, scared the shit out of me. I had no advanced warning. No one ever, look, you're looking at me like no one ever talked to me about it. That's what it's like to not get a secret memo.
Okay.
And I had that experience all the time.
So instructions for living.
And then it's instructions for learning and instructions for life. I remember on Anne's fifth reunion when you had a lot of friends come and stay over, and you went to the fifth reunion at HBS, and they all appeared before we were going to go, and they all came down wearing like appropriate things, you know, And I was like, how did everybody know what to wear? Like, and everyone was wearing, it was all in like a set of acceptable ranges of things. I was like, did you guys talk about it? And she said, no. Somebody gave somebody a secret memo at some point. I have never been on the distribution list of any of those things. And so I am.
You were sure that was a conspiracy?
I was totally sure it was a conspiracy.
Yeah, of course.
So I'm, the way I embody being a justice warrior is that I try to correct the memo. I am just like distributing pamphlets, secret memo pamphlets, everywhere I go.
Do you still feel left out by not being privy to the secret memos?
All the time. Now, I admit that I'm probably not as accurate, but I am so prone to the conspiracy theory of being left off the distribution list of the secret memo. It is now instinctual.
You were also very ambitious, and you said that you weren't the smartest, the funniest, or the most creative in your family, but you were the most ambitious. Where did that competitive spirit come from?
I don't know, because certainly not with anyone else in my family. There wasn't any ambition anywhere. I don't know. I've always been gnaw-off-a-limb competitive. I don't know where it comes from. Maybe it was a way to get out. And also, I feel like I was... It's not that I was underestimated. It's just that no one else had any ambition for me either.
Oh, maybe that's what it is.
And so I had to have the ambition.
I'm so ambitious that it scares Roxanne, my wife. We play Scrabble a lot. We love playing Scrabble with each other. But she says very accurately that I'm both a sore winner and a sore loser.
What does being a sore winner look like?
Then I get guilty. I feel guilty that I've won. And then I accuse Roxanne of letting me win.
Oh my gosh. Oh my gosh.
I know. Ouch. It's so screwed up on so many levels. It's amazing that she even plays a game with
it. It is amazing.
It truly is amazing.
Yeah. I guess that is what love is.
Yeah. That is what love is. Absolutely. Yeah. Anyway, by the time you were 12, you had a job. You worked from 8 a.m. to 12 a.m., I think, every day you didn't have school.
Yeah, well, for the four-hour blocks are from 8 a.m. to noon.
Okay. Yeah. So you were making $1.25 an hour. What were you doing? And what were you, how on earth were you only making $1.25 an hour? I mean, even when I'm older than you, when I started working, minimum wage was like $6 an hour.
Yeah, so it was below minimum wage. I remember going down to the corner store, which was just at the bottom of the hill. And it was a gross little town grocery store where everyone came to get their newspaper and coffee and sandwiches, buttered roll, because it was Long Island. So I'm not sure that the rest of our listeners will react the way that you and I just nonverbally did. But if you know, you know.
You know, you know.
So I made a lot of buttered rolls. When I went down there and I said I asked for a job, and the store owner said, well, when do you want to work? And I said, from 8 to noon every day. I don't have school. And he said, how much do you want to make? And I said, $1.25 an hour.
So it's like, hired. And child labor laws be damned.
Yeah. I remember I didn't make minimum wage until I came back and worked there when I wasn't at basketball camps in college. I would come back and work there. And that's when it got raised to minimum wage. I didn't become a good negotiator until later in life, and I've never been a great negotiator for me. I became a great negotiator when I negotiated on behalf of others, and then I'm like super fierce and awesome, but I've never been a very good negotiator for me.
And you also started working early. You got your first leadership job when you were 14 in South America, where you were volunteering with an organization called Amigos, which is sort of a mini Peace Corps, you've described it as. What kind of work were you doing? How did you find a position like that? And how long did you do it for?
Yeah, I actually wasn't 14, but we had volunteers that were that young.
Oh, okay.
So I was a little bit older. I did it in the summer. I started working with the program the summer after my freshman year in college.
Okay, so a bit older, yeah.
So I was a bit older. I did find my way to Latin America, Haiti, actually, through a different program. I think I was maybe 14 or 15. And I do think part of that was just hunger to see the world beyond Ohio. I had a dear friend across the street whose mother was Venezuelan. And in English, she was a fairly reserved woman. And then she would get on the phone to her family and speak this magical language and turn into a completely different human being. And the rules of my household were fairly typical, WASPy. The range of permissible emotion was relatively narrow. And I was totally captivated by this magical language, this whole region. And I think from a young age started plotting ways to get down there and experience a different way of living, a larger emotional spectrum, a different relationship with life, a different relationship with vitality, a different relationship with the body. I think all that stuff was really captivating to me. And so public health was an industry that was willing to hire unskilled labor. And so I ended up working in rural communities on simple health projects. Typically, they were being run by local governments. It was more an exchange program than a public health program, but that was the framework. And I had an extraordinary run with this experience, got very interested in the idea of leadership, the idea of human capacity, what happens to human beings when you push them into experiences that they don't think they can handle, finding shared humanity with people whose life experiences were radically different from mine. Like all the things that are deeply energizing to me at this point in my life, the seeds were all planted in those experiences.
I read that you spent your summers working in Ecuador, Honduras, the Dominican Republic, and Brazil, and you ended up eventually working at Amigo's headquarters as the regional director for South America and the Caribbean. And you've stated that it was a profound privilege to be part of the volunteers' transformation and to help a young person evolve into their better future self at sometimes astonishing speed. And it was completely addictive. And when I read that, I felt like, oh, there was the birth of Anne Morriss, the entrepreneur and leadership coach and consultant.
Yeah, I think that's where all the conviction was born around the speed at human beings' ability to change, the speed at which they can change, just the profound impact of being exposed to difference, different points of views, different life experiences, the alchemy of those differences coming together. I mean, it all started there. And I think probably back in Mrs. Fitzgerald's kitchen, where she would transform into this other person, which was really just all these parts of her that were relatively dormant in a suburb in Cincinnati, Ohio.
So you were working in Latin America. Frances, you were working in a little grocery store. What did you both think you wanted to do professionally with your lives at that point?
I didn't know anything of that I was going to do. I remember even in applying for college, it was such a haphazard thing, and I ended up sending drafts in instead of the actual things. And I mean, it was a disaster of all of the application process. And knowing, I ended up going to a college. I went to Brandeis University for my first year. I don't even recall applying to it.
You didn't visit it beforehand.
No,
I know that.
Never. So, and then, you know, didn't, for example, know that it was a Jewish school, which didn't matter except for it is, and it's knowable. That was the level of what the secret memos I didn't have, even of what I was applying to. I didn't know how to apply. So, and then going to college, I couldn't imagine what I was going to major in. The only thing I could do was math. So the major was fine, but then you had to have a minor. And I was like, oh my gosh, how am I going to do that? I wasn't thinking very far ahead on the chessboard. It wasn't until after playing college basketball where I knew I was going to be a basketball coach. By that time, I had worked coaching basketball every summer, working basketball camps. So that was the thing I was sure I was going to do. but I got dislodged. My competitive instincts dislodged me from that. I had friends who, I hated school, like even when I was in college.
Yeah, I read that when you went to Brandeis, it was the first time you felt misery.
That is true. I don't even know how you knew that. I don't recall ever saying it. It was the first time I ever felt misery. I had a rough childhood, but I never felt misery. But Brandeis was a horrible experience for me. And then I transferred to Penn. I don't even know how that happened. And it wasn't as miserable, but I hated school. I hated going to class. And so imagine my surprise when I applied for graduate school.
And then a PhD.
And then a PhD.
and then becoming a teacher.
All of these things surprising me among everyone else in my life when they were surprised. And it all happened because I had friends who were doing it. What was I going to do, lose?
Yeah, in the grand scheme of things, I wish I'd felt that competitive school-wise rather than having it all sort of projected into Scrabble. But nevertheless.
So I feel like I stumbled into all of these things, all of them.
Now, if you were really interested in becoming a basketball coach, what would a PhD in math do for you in that regard?
Well, it's a very good question. So my friends were all going to get PhDs in English, obviously. I was very fond of the English majors.
She has a type, Debbie.
And as Anne likes to remind me, it doesn't always appear that it's my first language, but it is my only language. I couldn't major in English. And so the only thing I could major in was something applied math. And so I went to business school for operations management, which is applied math, essentially. I got my PhD in the only thing I could possibly get my PhD in. So it wasn't that I had any grand scheme or grand plan. In fact, my plan was to go be a college basketball coach, but there wasn't anything else I could do. And also, I wasn't a very rigorous thinker at the time. Like, why not go, like, there must have been places you could go to college for, you know, gym or whatever one goes to. I don't know what one.
PE.
Like, there must have been somebody doing something in somewhere. But it never even occurred to me. In fact, where did I go? I went to Penn as an undergrad. So I went to Wharton, which is in the same university. Like, I wasn't a very broad thinker. I was ambitious, but not specifically ambitious.
You started teaching while you were getting your PhD at Wharton. And I think it's there that you started to feel that being in the front of the class was where
everything.
You belonged.
That changed everything. I would teach review sessions for a class. So there were, I don't know, maybe 800 students in the Wharton program. And they would take this class and then I would hold review sessions. And very quickly, people maybe wouldn't go to class. They would just go to the review sessions. And so I figured it out. And I knew I hated going to class, hated it. And so I wanted to give people a compelling reason to go to class. And I provided the secret memos.
Right.
Well, it turns out that those are two key elements for teaching. And then a faculty member got sick at the last minute once. And so I actually taught the class, not just the review sessions. And that was the first time I thought, maybe it's not going to be basketball. Maybe it's going to be this other academic thing. Although I had no idea how I was going to actually get my PhD because, like, the thought of how I would write a paper, none of that seemed possible to
me.
What
did you write your thesis on?
Showed it to Anne, and when she came into the office the first time.
First date.
I was in a field where everyone studied manufacturing, and that was what operations was. I hated manufacturing. I was interested in services, which was 70% of the economy. And so I studied service operations. What I would call it is I studied everything you couldn't drop on your foot. And it's just how things work. And then, like now, I thought everything was fixable. And so I would just look at where people had conventional wisdom that this would happen, and I just showed when it didn't. And that ended up being, I think, every single paper I wrote, my dissertation, all of it was questioning conventional wisdom.
You joined the University of Rochester Simon School of Business after completing your PhD. How did you begin to develop your teaching style? And as a very popular teacher at Harvard Business School, and having been in your class, You have a very distinct, very charismatic teaching style. How did you develop that?
I do think it was the mixture of the secret memo and compelling reason to come to class. Like, I hated class. I mean, I can't describe how uncomfortable I felt in it. I didn't feel like I learned when I was there, so I would have to go teach myself elsewhere, which turned out to be a useful skill. But I learned math through textbooks, not in a classroom. And I didn't want other people to have to do it. The charisma, I'm not even sure I know what it means in that setting, although I am...
You sparkle in the front of a room.
Well, I do feel most comfortable one-to-many. So I'm at my least comfortable one-to-one. Sorry, baby.
20 years and I have all the
She's looking at Anne, not me. Yeah. She's looking at Anne, not me.
I feel most intimate when it's one to many. In fact, the larger the audience, the more vulnerable I'll be, the more human I'll be, the more that when you were describing the wider range of emotions, I have the wide range of emotions, the more permission I have. So there is something about if the bigger, the better, that just works for me.
Hey, y'all, it's Elise. I have another podcast to tell you about. It's called In the Making. It's an original podcast brought to you by Adobe Express. It's the all-in-one content creation app included in your Creative Cloud membership. In the Making takes an honest look at the challenges and rewards of being part of the creator economy. The series kicks off with Puno, who is a creative director and educator. On the show, host Teresa Au explores how you can use the principles of design to create a career you love. Puno did it. Puno is a web designer and content creator and the founder of an online education platform called I Love Creatives. And on the show, Puno shares her journey from working on the Call of Duty video game to building both a design studio and a trade school for digital design. Puno has practical advice for taking a thoughtful and iterative approach to career building. Most importantly, this show is actionable. It's about how you can take your own next step in the creative world and into the creator economy. It'll help you discover creative, intriguing people who are making a living, and it'll probably inspire you no matter what you do. I know it certainly did for me. Search for In the Making in your podcast player. My thanks to In the Making and Adobe Express for their support.
Anne, what did you want to be as you were traveling all through Latin America, helping people find themselves?
I think I figured out that public health was not a good fit for me. The premise of that world is that it's not a move fast and fix things. And it's a community of extraordinarily talented and committed humans that are working on very long-term problems. And I knew that wasn't the right fit for me. I loved being in motion. I loved trafficking in human potential. and I didn't know what that could possibly translate into in terms of a career. Where I ended up migrating was into the economic development branch of the development space. That felt like a better fit for me. I started working on the issue of how do you create environments where entrepreneurs can thrive in places that weren't designed perfectly for entrepreneurship. Silicon Valley is designed perfectly for entrepreneurship. Boston is designed almost perfectly for entrepreneurship. São Paulo, Brazil is not. What are the levers that you can push on in terms of policy, in terms of capital, that start to create an ecosystem where small, vulnerable companies can start and can ultimately thrive? Now, the most interesting thing, the most part of small, vulnerable companies to me are the human beings inside them. And so I knew when I got into that world that I was starting to circle something that could potentially turn into a career. And then I was working in a startup in that space where it was also clear to me that the human beings running the place were these big variables, particularly at that stage of the company, in terms of whether the enterprise was going to succeed or not. And that question and those combinations of questions got very, you know, was very interesting to me, which is how I ended up on the MBA track, because it was a program, an environment that took those questions seriously.
Well, you started out at Brown University. You got a Bachelor of Arts degree, which really surprised me because you then went on to Harvard to get an MBA. What inspired you? From what I understand, you applied to one business school, and it was Harvard. That's like chutzpah.
Well, I didn't know if it was the right path, and I thought that...
And you're a snob.
I am. I can't totally deny that. But a part of the calculus for me is I don't know if this is the right path. I'm going to give it my best shot, and I was pretty good at getting into things. I only applied to one undergraduate school as well. And so I knew how to apply to things, and so I thought, okay, I'm going to do my thing, and if it's the right fit, this institution will respond and open its doors. And it did, and it was a great experience. And we overlapped on campus. For the record, Frances was never my teacher. But I did first see Frances on a stage.
The one to many.
And in this one to many. And it the translation to one-on-one was confusing in the beginning, baby. It's like, wait, where is she? And I was an older student. It was really fun to go back to school. The learning model's really fun. You know, it's much different than being a more passive undergraduate. But what I studied at Brown was the history of the Americas and the evolution of these societies and the clash, blending, creative friction of all of these different human elements. That is a through line from, you know, standing at the top of the stairs and saying, give me liberty or give me death.
Yeah.
So that part wasn't a surprise to anyone around me. The business school left turn was a surprise. And if you had told my, 15-year-old self that I would end up at Harvard Business School and now be in the game of helping capitalists be better at capitalism, it would be an absurd ending to the story.
I'm more in Frances's camp of applying to things. And actually, I'm sort of in the Venn diagram of both of you, because I also only applied to one graduate school, but didn't get in. And so I did quite a lot of that in my 20s. I would pick one thing that I thought I wanted to do, not really designating it as a sign, but just, this is what I want to do. But always was one after another rejected from that one option. Frances, you applied to Harvard 5 times. They said no to you when you applied to go to college, when you applied for your PhD, you got turned down, you applied to be on the faculty for the first time, and when you went up for tenure. What kept you persisting in the face of so much rejection?
I do.
The snob in me wants to clarify that you were ultimately tenured.
Oh, yeah, of course. Yes, let's be clear.
But,
yes.
You know.
And you're a distinguished professor, yeah. Absolutely. And have won many prizes for the best professor.
I recall I was like, we're not losing this one, honey. Let's go.
I don't ever let the decisions of others influence my life's trajectory. So saying no to me is not the same as saying no to Ann Morriss. Say no to Ann Morriss, it's one strike and you're out. She will never revisit you. Me, if you say no to me, I just hear not now. Mm. I don't take it seriously. I think I probably could have presented myself better. A different person will be making the decision. And I had a feeling, and it just became clearer and clearer, and then it turned out to be right, that it was the right place for me. And it has turned out to be the right place for me. So I just had an instinct that it was the right form of being a very practice-oriented school. And so, for example, I love bringing everything I know to students, whereas many colleagues at many other business schools like bringing everything they know to colleagues. So they'll read each other's academic journals. If I write a paper, I want it to be read by students. I mean, yes, I'll have it go into a publication, but my main consumer are executives and students. There's lots of great schools, but Harvard is the number one school in that dimension. We call it being very close to practice. So I just knew it was where I was supposed to be. And I unlike Anne, I don't know how to get in. I don't ever got the secret memos. I still now wouldn't, if I applied for something, I would have no expectation I would get in. I consider that Anne applied for tenure for me the second time.
And the first step you took to starting your own company was from an ominous phone call you got a few days after you and Frances had your first child. A man on the phone called and asked whether your baby boy, just a few days old and sleeping peacefully in the next room, was still alive. When you responded, yes, he's still alive, he asked you to go check and confirm and then come back to the phone. What happened next? That's just unthinkable.
Yeah, so our oldest inherited a rare metabolic condition called MCAD deficiency, MCAD deficiency. And so he is essentially missing the enzyme that converts fat into sugar that you can use when your body runs out of sugar. It's a very important part of your metabolism. And in infancy, your sugars are all over the place. And so it's actually quite easy to sleep past the amount of sugar you have in your body. So by the miracle of newborn screening, that little heel prick that most parents get to kind of forget about that happens within the first few hours of a kiddo's birth, the data came back and it was pretty clear that his levels were off, essentially. And I think they ran the test again to make sure. There was a little bit of a lag, so we had gone home. And I can remember where I was in the apartment. I can remember what I was wearing. I can remember the floor. And it was not my doctor. It was this voice from the state of Massachusetts. And this voice said, well, you know, is your child still alive? And I said, I think so. I just put him down for a nap. And he said, can you go check and then come back to the
phone? I'll hold
and then come back to the phone. And the thing in retrospect, having immersed ourselves in so many systems, that's so painful about that moment, not for us per se. I mean, our son's doing great, and I'll fill in the blanks, but I'm sure that's a protocol that they came by the hard way.
Mm. And your son is 15?
He's 16.
16.
He's doing extraordinarily well on this list of rare diseases. It's kind of the one you want. He essentially outgrows it. But the first couple years, we had to feed him around the clock every couple hours, and it was those were just high anxiety times. And then when he would get sick with something else, which is metabolically stressful, you know, the flu, or, you know, kids get sick all the time. So we would go and fight it off with a special IV to keep his sugars up. And so there were a couple years there where there was a hospital bag packed and by the door, and we were in and out of Children's Hospital, just keeping this kiddo alive.
You decided to start a company aimed at reducing the odds of having an unhealthy child when using donor sperm. Tell us more about that decision.
Yeah, well, as we get, you know, we have this kind of fix it, can do lesbian spirit. I'm sure it was also a way to metabolize for lack of a better word, you know, my own experience in those years. But one of the things that was kind of shocking to us was how much further advanced the genomic science was than clinical practice. And what had happened was, I mean, this was 16 years ago, but at the time, the scientists and clinicians had kind of stopped talking to each other 20 years previously. They're motivated by different things. So, you know, the kind of two branches of genetic science, the clinical science and the research science, went in different directions, and they had different vocabulary for the same things. Like, it really was a dramatic break, and I was convinced that I could just get everyone in a room and reintroduce everyone to each other and realize we all wanted the same things. And there was a real opportunity to make the screening protocols for donor sperm and donor eggs much better, because really where the risk lives is at the combination of the two parents. It's not that, it's actually very, very rare that an individual donor is passing on disease risk and doesn't somehow know it and isn't somehow sick themselves. It's really what happens when the biological parents come together. And so I started a company with an extraordinary scientist named Lee Silver, who had invented a way to see that disease risk at much higher resolution. And we knew, you know, we had a better way of doing things. And, you know, he's kind of set out down this path. And we underestimated the complexity of changing clinical practice in America. You have to bring patients along, doctors along, the payers and insurance companies along. And then you have to bring the venture capitalists with you. And they have to literally run the numbers and be convinced that you're going to solve all of these problems on a timeline that's going to work for their own investors. And we started down the path, and I think this, we all kind of looked at this mountain and realized just the probabilities of any business hitting it out of the park are low. You know, it's a portfolio play. But I think we had a great run. It was the whole experience was, you know, 6-7 years of building this company. But it just ultimately didn't make sense to the people writing the checks. And I understand. I was super frustrated because we had...
You had figured it out. You had the thing.
Yeah, we had the thing. We could have saved a lot of kids.
Getting that phone call.
Many fewer families would have gotten that phone call.
I believe you sold the science, though, didn't you?
Yeah, we did. The science did find a home. And I don't know where it landed, but it is not in clinical practice today.
You must have been able to learn so much that you can bring into your own work now. I mean, I think the most valuable thing that I bring to my students are overcoming the obstacles that have stood in my way. I couldn't be the teacher I am if I didn't have that experience.
It was a big lesson for me in the gifts of, you know, what we label failure and frustration and plan A not working out. So much of what I learned in that ride, thank you to all the venture capitalists who paid for my education in this regard, but so much of what I've learned I've been able to pass on to other entrepreneurs, and it deeply informs the work we do, helping people work through the challenges of leadership and building their own organizations.
In 2018, you founded the Leadership Consortium. So tell us what the goal of that organization was when you first started it and what you're doing with it now.
Yeah, well, it was deeply informed by Frances's experience. She took a time out from the Harvard Business School with the school's blessing to go work with Uber at the height of its leadership crisis. And you got a very firsthand look at some of the patterns of where underrepresented leaders were getting stuck in their trajectory in Silicon Valley. And the pattern was really clear in that small investments in learning, exposure, kind of peer-to-peer network, all of these things that were getting in the way of people having the careers and the impact that they wanted in these organizations were very solvable problems. And so we designed this program really for anyone who is interested in accelerating their careers. And we bring in, many of them are friends of Frances, you know, fantastic professors, to work with students for just a couple months at a time. And really what we're trying to achieve in terms of the metric of success that we care about is greater confidence at the end of the program than when people started. And we have a pretty reliable hit rate.
Oh, it's an amazing hit rate. I mean, we learned so many things, but one, the power of education and all of the other things that we do. But it's also, you know, and it brings us to the current DEI debate. So as you were just speaking, I was like, yeah, this is one of the reasons where I get so enraged when I hear overconfident, underinformed people talking about DEI. Like, the reason that DEI exists is because there were demographic tendencies associated with who thrived. And we saw people being artificially held back. You could see the profiles. You could see, like, it was unmistakable. And so we're removing the artificial obstacles that were getting in the way, which is, I think, what brought every single person to DEI to the table. It wasn't to give unfair advantage. It was to remove unfair disadvantage. And so then when I hear people saying, I want to blow up DEI, I'm like, you want to go back to there being demographic tendencies associated with who's permitted to have a chance of thriving. I don't believe it. I don't. That's where it came from. And it was so clear to me in Silicon Valley, not just at Uber, but I had a chance to go to all of the companies. And you, once you had that lens on, you couldn't not see it. So when he left, and I was like, I had taken a 2-year leave from Harvard, but it only took a year to turn around Uber. And so then I was like, well, I can go back early. And then we had a conversation. We were like, we have this observation. Do we think it's going to get addressed if we don't do it? And we estimated the probability of it being addressed at 0.
Mm. Yeah.
And so that's what we did. And the nice thing about the company is that we now bring people together across company, and that has been the magic of it. And so amazing companies that typically don't learn together, they all have very insular learning programs. So they might send one person to a, they send a cohort to us at a time. And so we get to really work with their companies to help accelerate them.
You and Anne and another writer wrote a really powerful op-ed in the New York Times back in January. I believe it was January 24th. And for anybody that is interested in learning more about Anne and Frances's viewpoints on this topic, I would suggest that you look up that article, and we'll have it in some show notes. You've since gone on to write several best-selling books together. So you live together, you have a business together, and you write together. So what is it like sharing your life on so many different dimensions with each other every day?
Unbelievably rich, richer for all of it. And anytime we've had anything less than that, where one of us was doing something without the other, it didn't feel as fulfilling, and it certainly wasn't as high quality. So I can speak from myself, my doing anything in the presence of Anne, 1 + 1 adds at least 0, and sometimes 2 zeros. It's just so much richer the more we get to do together, and the conspicuous absence of it. So I genuinely can't imagine doing anything without her.
I want to talk about your most recent book, Move Fast and Fix Things, The Trusted Leader's Guide to Solving Hard Problems. And I believe that the seed of the book was inspired by Mark Zuckerberg's 5-word motto, Move Fast and Break Things, which you've said you think is terrible advice.
It's terrible advice, you know, and of course a 24-year-old boy came up with it. right? The harm I originally thought it did is that it gave people permission to break things. But then it wasn't until the larger harm revealed itself to us that we were moved to write the book, which is the deep harm is that it gave speed a bad name. So many well-intentioned people go slowly out of fear of breaking things. And when I say so many, I'm going to round it off to everyone. I mean, everywhere I go, every day, I see people giving each other license to go slower in the name of some virtue. And I feel like I have the secret memo that going slower will give you lower quality with certainty. And yet everyone is inducing everyone else to go slower as a virtue. And so what we're trying to do is spread the word that the increased metabolic rate is what actually allows you to go further. It's a momentum thing. And that what is breaking things is not the speed. It's the other things you're doing, like breaking trust, like all of the reasons that people want to slow down. Things don't get better when you slow down. They get better when you fix the other things. You can fix those at pace. But we keep telling each other to go slow. So now we just have people going slow and leading to mediocrity. It is an epidemic around the world. And so that this is, to me, a classic example of a secret memo that needs to be distributed around the world.
Early on in the book, you state, a cornerstone of our work is that leadership is the practice of imperfect humans leading imperfect humans. If you accept this as a reasonable starting point, then it follows that any collection of us builds imperfect organizations. Is that okay to have an imperfect organization? Do you suggest that we feel more comfortable being imperfect?
Well, no, the idea with that statement is to forgive yourself for the imperfections. Mm. You know, there's, I feel like so much of our emotional energy goes towards the question. We're trying to say it's a given. Like, you didn't get it right.
And you could be a better version of yourself tomorrow than you are today.
Yeah, and so instead of worrying, did I get this right or not, let's assume you didn't, because none of us do. So now that's the jumping off point of curiosity to go out and figure, well, can you make it better tomorrow than it was today? And we're trying to invite people into that orientation that's going to allow them to make progress and build organizations where other people have a reasonable chance of thriving.
We know that rate of improvement matters so much more than wherever you are today. And yet there are so many organizations that are so protective of where they are today, and they have stopped improving. They're doing things the same way they were doing yesterday and last year and 10 years ago, and without shame. It's actually with pride. And I'm like, you have denied yourself a learning opportunity for 10 years and you're proud. I don't understand. Like, I genuinely don't understand it.
There's also, I believe, an epidemic of people being really unhappy at their jobs. I listened to an interview that you did with Chris Anderson where you talked about how 70% of the workforce in the United States is unhappy in their work.
And yet, we are super proud of how we're doing things, and we don't feel an urgent need to be better versions of ourselves tomorrow than we are today. That is the part that doesn't make any sense. And every single time we've gone into an organization that has said, we want to be on an improvement journey, they get on it quickly and steeply. And so it's all also so possible. And so this is, I think, simply a storytelling problem, which is why storytelling figures so prominently in this book, which was a surprise to me as an, you know, as
the applied math.
As the applied math, and like, we just have to figure out how to do it. And yet that was not enough. And then that's where I think Thursday was born in mm-hmm. our book.
Yeah. I mean, I think what's so inspiring about the book is that it's both a playbook and a journal. Yeah. You learn how to do things differently, but you also are able to learn through seeing other people experience changing their behavior and what results when you're able to do that. So many leadership books are about how to lead others. Mm-hmm. And in many ways, I've felt like your book is about how to change your leadership style to inspire others.
Yeah.
It's not about getting other people to do better work. It's about you doing better work that inspires other people to follow your lead. The book helps people understand how to build their business and learn quickly while avoiding very costly mistakes. And the narrative arc of the book is inventive. The methodology is based on a 5-day work week, which you also talk about, Anne, in your TED Talk. What made you decide to organize the book in this way?
I'm trying to remember if there was a decision point. I mean, I remember that we proposed it to our editor as a five-day plan to improve your organization. And she was like, oh yeah, that's a great metaphor. We were like, no, we're fucking serious. Like, there's a lot you can do in a week.
There's so much you can do in a week. And I do think it comes that we would go with organizations. We're always trying to get them to be more ambitious and to take less time. It's always what we do. And when they are more ambitious and they take less time, they accomplish more. So a secret memo that needs distribution is stop asking for incremental change over a long period of time. You're better off not doing it. So we knew it had to go faster. And so we're constantly coaching people to go faster and faster. And then a month was too long. And so then the week was the next unit of analysis. Like, a quarter was way too long, because you can do, I mean, when you were asking Anne about the astonishing rate that people can change, like, change can happen in an instant. Mm-hmm. Do you have any instants or in a week? Like a lot of instants. There's also, when we look at like the actual work that's done, if you just stack it all, 40 hours is a long time. I mean, that's a long time. And what we encourage people to do is take out all of the downtime and just stack all of it together. Now, we have become, I think, less bold in saying, we're like, look, it's going to take longer than a week. But honestly, what we think in our mind is it shouldn't.
Right.
But we have learned in polite company to say it's going to take more than a week, but please don't think about it as 6 months or a year.
I'm sorry to ask you to do this because I know it's really sort of performative, but I really think it would be helpful for our listeners to take us through the five steps, even if you want to do it really quickly. But yeah. Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday.
Sure. So on Monday, you have to identify the real problem. If anyone who listens to Fixable, where people call in with their problems, you'll realize we end up solving a different problem than they call in every single time. Well, that's true in organizations too. So the presenting problem is never the problem you have to solve. And there's a very systematic way to do it. So that's Monday, because you will spend an infinite amount of time solving the symptom. And so we get that there. The goal of Tuesday is to come up with just the first pass at a plan. We call it a good enough plan. And for sure, if you have a problem and it involves people, you have lost trust. And so we have to rebuild trust. So that's part of having the good enough plan.
Let me just interrupt you, because I do have a question about that. If a leader in an organization is looking to build trust, which is so important now more than ever, what would be the first thing that you would recommend that they do?
Understand that trust is actually a summary statistic of three component parts, and the three component parts are authenticity, logic, and empathy. And if I am struggling to build trust with you, I shouldn't try to solve for trust. I should figure out, do I have an authenticity, logic, or empathy problem, and solve for them. And so much of the unproductive effort is that I'm using an authenticity solution for an empathy problem, for example. And so get down to the component part. Trust is so solvable. So you're right. It is the biggest problem, and it is so solvable at the individual and organizational level.
Wednesday's a fun day. Wednesday, you're making new
friends.
Wednesday's
the best day. Yeah.
Talk about Wednesday.
Yeah.
On Wednesday, whatever you've done it by somewhat traditional means on Monday and Tuesday. You've gone to the usual suspects. You've gone to the usual things. And that's great, and do it. And then on Wednesday, take note of everyone you didn't talk to who could possibly be helpful, and bring them to the table. And so by make new friends, it's the clarion call to who could possibly have a stake in this that you haven't brought to attention. So the example I often give is that at the Harvard Business School, we are proud that when we talk about our promotion rate, like we're like, oh, look, it's so stingy. We're so selective. But I see it as an unimproving operating system. We have never gotten better over decades, and we're not ashamed. We're proud. And I know why, because the senior faculty get together all the time and talk about junior faculty without the junior faculty present. Well, that's because we skip Wednesday. We don't make new friends. And imagine if we brought in the perspective of junior faculty, we could then improve the promotion rates, and we could actually have an improving operating system. So Wednesday, I think, is the fun day. It's the invite everybody to the table that you haven't yet. You don't have to feel guilty about not having them before, but now's the day. Who's not there? And then once you invite them to the table, realize that they're going to say things to please you in the beginning. And so what we have to do is convince them that we don't want to dwell on what they know in common with us. We want to know all of their uncommon thoughts. And so Wednesday is make new friends and get their unique insights. And then your good enough plan just adds a zero. Now we're going.
For somebody that's been at a company a long time, you recommend that they reach out to someone who started last week to get more information and learn more about what they don't know that they don't know.
Yeah, you want to get someone before they're that is still saying, we do things like what? And it's, you know, before
I mean, our ability to adapt is one of our great superpowers as humans. Yeah. But you want
before
you have truly adapted, you want to get the insight of someone who just showed up and is looking around.
So Thursday is about telling a story.
Yeah, I mean as human beings, we think in stories and learn in metaphors. So one of our observations, we do a lot of work around change and changing organizations, is that the power of storytelling is underutilized in that. It's often an afterthought. And when you center it and really bring intentionality to it, it's a way to activate the entire organization, not just in your presence, but in your absence. It's about literally putting language to where were we, why are we moving somewhere else, and what is it going to feel like when we get there. Even the most sophisticated organizations in the world are deeply hungry for this. We push all kinds of teams on this one, and it's a really, really profound lever for progress.
Friday is about going fast. Oh,
that's my favorite day.
I'm not surprised.
All the tension gets released on Friday.
Yeah.
And so what does it mean to have that tension released and to go fast? I think it's the day of action, right?
Yeah.
That's when you
it's
put
when
into
you get to
play.
Do all the things. So, and if you put Friday, I mean, move fast and break things is bringing Friday to Monday or to Tuesday or to Wednesday, right? So you have to do it on Friday, which is why it takes a whole week. So there are so many things we do to go slowly, and you just have license to break through them. So like some of my favorite are when people try to be great at everything. You know, if you want to go fast, you have to articulate, this is what I'm going to be great at, and this is what I'm going to be bad at.
It's a sacrifice.
It's a sacrifice, and you have to be, and when you have to be articulate about it, otherwise we're each going to make our own private decisions. And then you might have made progress from 8 to 9, and then over here, I'm going to bring us back from 9 to 10. And so another one of my favorite ones is that, you know, conflict occurs, and most of us avoid conflict. So conflict will happen. We avoid it, hoping it will go away.
Right. Magically.
Magically.
Poof.
Turns out, not only does it not go away, it grows without our attention. And so now the problem that I could have trivially solved today, it's a bigger problem in a week. It's a gigantic problem in a month, in 6 months. So leaning into conflict is what we do on Friday. Like there's just all of these, Friday is just a whole list of delicacies of how do you remove the speed bumps so that you can go fast. And it's so liberating. And the reason it animates me so much is I get to watch people. It's where you teach people how to have good meetings. You teach people who to invite to meet. Like you just unlock all the things on Friday. It's the best day of the week.
I think we could have a whole separate conversation on how to teach people how to have good meetings.
That's a whole podcast.
I'm quite evangelical about it. Anytime.
In tandem with the book's launch, you also launched Fixable, your wonderful podcast, giving advice on workplace challenges. What has this new medium and realm been like for you?
You know, audio only is... I got captivated by it on over the pandemic, mm-hmm. and started teaching cases on Clubhouse, and really because I didn't think you could do anything, and I didn't listen to podcasts before, and then I was like, oh my gosh, audio only is better. It's more intimate. I'm not distracted by the visuals. Particularly if I put a headset on, I'm like never more present. So it's this superpower that's like within plain sight for us. So I love that part of like accompanying people intimately around the world. And then we get to practice what we preach. We can reach people anywhere, and we think you can solve hard problems in 30 minutes. And so that's what we do. And it's like flying without a net. I mean, I go every one of the episodes, Anne's the host, I'm the co-host. But I hear the description of the problem, and I'm like, what are we going to do?
This is the one.
We're not going to solve
it's
this.
It's not fixable.
And then...
Do you think that's going to happen, though? Do you think you're ever going to
I think at the beginning of every single call. Anne brings us to a place where she figures out what the real problem is and presents it as a layup, and then we can solve it. No, I don't think it'll ever happen. I think we can solve every problem. But I can tell you, I can't alone. I could never do it without Anne.
My last question is about something I heard you say on Arnav Roy's podcast. You said that one of the things you have in common is that you both like to go towards burning buildings, not away from them. I'm wondering, how do you manifest that kind of courage?
Well, you find a friend. So it's that courage is possible for me to access with Frances standing next to me, and it's much harder when I'm alone. So phone a friend, find a buddy, can be part of it. I also think the burning building metaphor for us is not about us. So I think that's what it may present as courage, but what it doesn't feel like that. It feels like a possibility to have impact and play a role in helping people get out of their own way. Most people are very hungry for that permission, and it often takes someone from outside the story to come in and make the invitation. And it's a total privilege to be able to play that role.
You know, the it doesn't feel like courage. It feels like the only thing we can't provide is the will to change. Well, the burning building provides the will.
Mm.
I wish we didn't need burning buildings. I wish people were more proactive. I want people to be more proactive, but with certainty, the burning building does it. And so the reason I go towards it doesn't have courage at all is I know what's on the other side of it. And that impact is assured when you go there.
And the other thing we love about the burning building is people are collectively at a point where they're open and willing to change. And it, you know, you kind of hit that willingness at a scale that makes rapid change possible. And that's what is really animating for both of us.
Anne and Frances, thank you so much for making so much work that matters. And thank you for joining me today on Design Matters. Frances Frei and Anne Morriss's podcast is called Fixable. And their most recent book is titled Move Fast and Fix Things, The Trusted Leader's Guide to Solving Hard Problems. You can read lots more about the work they do at anneandfrances.com. This is the 19th year we've been podcasting Design Matters, and I'd like to thank you for listening. And remember, we can talk about making a difference, we can make a difference, or we can do both. I'm Debbie Millman, and I look forward to talking with you again soon.
Design Matters is produced for the TED Audio Collective by Curtis Fox Productions. The interviews are usually recorded at the Masters in Branding program at the School of Visual Arts in New York City, the first and longest-running branding program in the world. The editor-in-chief of Design Matters Media is Emily Weiland.
You're fucking awesome.
I hope you didn't turn off the tape. I'm just going to have that as like my ringtone.